All your many blessings, Lord, just stood upon us all. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for those that are gathered together right now, Lord, to praise and glorify your name, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we come to praise your holy name, Lord Jesus. We come to hold up the bloodstained banner, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord Jesus, look upon us tonight, Lord. As we go forth with your praise, Lord Jesus. As we go forth, Lord Jesus, to sing your praises, Lord Jesus. As we go forth, Lord Jesus, to deliver your word, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for those that are gathered together right now, Lord, to praise and glorify your name, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for those may be on their way, Lord. He give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your anointing, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the angel, Lord Jesus, to call upon your name, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus. We ask you, Lord Jesus, bless and anoint the speaker and the teacher tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, look upon the musicians, Lord Jesus, praise and choir team combined together, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, look upon, Lord Jesus, those that are sick tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord, hold your love and mercy around them, Lord Jesus. Lead us and guide us, Lord, in the right direction, Lord, for it be your will, your way, your grace and your mercy, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God, I hope, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for victory back, tabernacle, Lord. Praise and wish and center where there is love, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord Jesus, Father, Pastor Timothy Hinkle, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God of hosts, Lord Jesus, look upon his sons, Lord Jesus, and his daughter, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord Jesus, look upon the Hinkle, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord Jesus, look upon, Lord Jesus, every disciple, Lord Jesus, a victory tabernacle, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence, Lord, in the name of Jesus. My God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord, lead us and guide us in the right direction, Lord. Lord, it's in your will, your way, your grace and your mercy, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord Jesus, guide our feet, Lord, our hands, Lord Jesus, eyes and ears, Lord Jesus. Lord God of hosts, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord, guide our mouths, Lord, bridle our tongues, Lord Jesus, so everything that's said and done, Lord, Lord, it's in your will, your way, your grace and your mercy, Lord Jesus. These blessings and others, we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Isn't God good?
All the time.
We had a beautiful time this morning. We're going to have another time in the Lord tonight.
Hallelujah.
And you know what? The two or three are gathered together for this thing is in our midst. Amen.
Amen. Victory Tabernacle, Family Worship Center, right here in Belfast, Ohio. And we are
on the move, and God is doing a good thing.
Amen.
And we just want to encourage you. We want to encourage our ministers of our name today, Ray and Barbara Young, and David Dodson, and Lily Watts, hallelujah, Ugo. So we just give God all the glory that He is enlarging all of our territory in Jesus' name, amen. He's expanding the ministry He's called us to, and we are expecting great and mighty things through each and every one of these ministers that God Himself has ordained. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. We're going to have worship. You want to worship the Lord with me? Amen. We're going to have worship tonight. So let's turn over to the praise and worship team at this time. And Sister Reed is going to come and lead us. Amen.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah. I know you probably get half tired hearing this, but we are so blessed. We are so blessed to have the Samoans.
Amen.
Our presence. Your presence, your joy. You know, you radiate. Just by your by looking at you, you can tell the love that the Lord has in you.
Amen.
And you know what? It rubs off.
Thank you.
That's good. Well, you ever feel that you're blessed more than somebody else?
Amen.
I think the Lord's marshal to Victory Tabernacle.
I do. Turn it on. Turn the mic on, please.
It's on.
Okay.
I just wasn't talking very loud.
That was awesome. That was awesome. I love when they all dance together. That is so fun. That is so good. Yeah, what's the young man's name?
Jarrell.
Yeah, Frankie's a young man too. Jarrell, that was awesome.
Yeah.
Did I say your name right? You know what? When they are young, train them up in the way they should go when they were old, anyway. Not the part of it.
Amen.
One of my children was writing with me yesterday and said to me, "Dad, remember when you told me, when I told you a few years ago that I didn't believe in God?" And I said, "Yeah." He goes, "Remember you told me it was just a phase?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You're right, it was just a phase."
Praise God.
I was so mad when you told me that. You know, but this goes to show you, though, that what they get in church, what they get in a godly home,
amen,
when you pour and you train and you teach about the things of God, it carries forward. And even though the devil tries to come in like a flood, and he tries to steal their faith, and he tries to kill them, and he tried to destroy the testimony, we serve a mighty God.
Yes,
and he does. He preserves our children. Yes. And he raises them up to be trees of righteousness. Amen.
Yes, amen.
Planted by water. And we used to sing that. I shall not be moved. Just like the tree. Planted by the water. Hallelujah. And you know what? Bishop asked you on our anniversary service, he said something, and his whole thing was, remain unchanged in a changing world, isn't it? And we're going to remain unchanged people of righteousness, children of the Most High God, no matter what the culture says around us, amen? No matter what people try to say, we're going to not be moved by what is politically correct, what is seems to be the theme of the day. They say we live in a post-church age or a post-modern age. I say we're the Church of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And it shall stand forever and ever and ever and ever. And Jesus himself shall rule on the throne of David. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That was so awesome. That was so awesome. Well, looky here.
Amen.
Brother Ray is going to sing another song.
Praise the Lord.
There'll be one song. Oh, what is that perfect? My God's going to bring it all together. So welcome, Brother Ray, again.
Amen.
Thank you.
He's singing with you.
Yes.
All right. Now here we are in front of you again.
Praise the Lord. Test, test. My check, my check. How many of you are blessed to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Yeah. Check, 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 check. I can't hear you. How many of you are blessed to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Yeah. And you know what I'm saying? How many of you are blessed to be in the house of the Lord tonight?
Thank you.
secrets out. We're going to put you on the spot more often. So, you know, my friends are aware.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Beautiful. That was awesome.
Amen.
I'm just full.
Amen.
I'm just so full of the Lord.
Amen.
He is so good to me.
Amen.
And you don't understand what it's like to be a pastor and have God give you a vision and then start seeing God bring it to pass.
That's right.
And it's so encouraging in your heart.
That's right.
Yes.
It's so encouraging to know that you're walking in the will of God. Amen?
Amen. Praise God.
We don't always stay in the will of God. We have to seek His face continually.
Yes. That's right.
But He is so faithful and just. And
yes,
no matter
yes,
what missteps we make or what mistakes we make, that He always causes us to come out ahead. Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good. For those who love God, called according to His purpose. I'll see Him fulfilled that in my lifetime and time and time again. Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God. This morning, we have a time, we have a program for this evening where it says that we were going to do ordination, commission, prayers. But we did that this morning.
That's right.
And I believe that we might have new family members of those that were being ordained that might be in the evening service that didn't make it to the morning. So we wanted to allow them to participate in what was going on, because family likes to be part of what's going on in the family life.
Praise God.
But since we have no new family members of our new members that were ordained, what we're going to do is we're going to pray.
Hallelujah.
We're going to pray right now. We're going to pray over them. So I would like Ray and Barbara Young, I would like David Dodson and William Watts, all pastors, amen, they all pastors. All of the anointing the comments, I figured it out. The Lord was telling me to have Sister Dodson, who's not behind the camera, to have her come say a few words. But what I want to do, I feel glad that the Holy Spirit wants her to pray for her husband. And Brother Watts and Rand Barber. So I just want to invite you to put you on the spot. Our recently ordained ministers.
Father God, we just thank you so much for the ordination that you have given to these ministers, God. And we just thank you for the new season that you brought them all into. We thank you that the Holy Spirit is going to continue to guide them and lead them to everything.
Because
when in between services, we were visiting a little bit at our home after lunch, and the Lord told me to take this picture off my wall that I had written a poem called A Vessel of Honor. And I said, give this to Pastor Dodson. And so I gave it to him, and he also told me to take this cross that had been given to me at the Washington and give it to Brother William. Just as mementos of this day and what God is doing. But look how mindful God is.
Yes, he is.
He is so mindful of you. Amen. So we're not going to show the clip from Peru. You watch it this morning, and that was at the recommendation of Barbara Gray. So they're not being cited. It was their recommendation. So we would like to welcome Brother David Dodson, an anointed evangelist, a mighty pastor, a strong husband, and an awesome father, to come and to bring the word tonight. And I'm going to invite all of us on the platform to go ahead and sit in the congregation tonight, because there's room for us out there. So
can you turn me up a little bit, please? Especially on the monitors, and
I don't talk real loud, and so that's good. If you can just knit some strength piece, and do you have it on there? Yeah. Or just need a piece then. I like strings, but just because you know, there's one thing I learned in ministry is that God can do more in a single second. Yeah, that's it. Than I can do in an entire hour of ministry. And one thing that I've learned just by being in ministry is that something more important than my voice is the voice of the Lord.
Amen.
And I feel that a lot of preachers have gotten away from the voice of the Lord, and they've fallen in love more with the sound of their own voice through a microphone than they have with the voice of the Lord spoken to their heart. And I just vowed that I would stop asking God to give me a word, and stop asking God to bless what I'm going to say, and instead just say what He says, because it's already blessed.
Man.
I just want God, if you could play what you were playing right as Pastor Watts was praying earlier, if you remember that. And one thing that I've noticed about services like this is atmospheres can change and shift throughout the entire service. And at one moment it can feel like we're here, and the next moment it feels like we're there. And it's not that one atmosphere is higher or lower than the other, it's that God is strategically dealing with different spirits over the course of the service, so that by the time the word goes forth, the heart is prepared to receive what God is going to say. And I really feel that God is going to speak to us tonight.
Praise God.
I want to turn this room really quick into a place of worship. I want to turn it into a house of prayer. I want to turn it into a prayer meeting. So let's just give our hearts and turn our affections to the Lord. Just build an altar right where you're at, and just ask God to meet you right where you're at and speak to you. Ask God, God, thank you so much. God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Abba God. We thank you for being a good God. Every time God shifts a meeting, every time God shifts a people, every time God shifts a church, He requires a new response. So that means that the response we gave last week, if we plan to go any further, we have to respond according to the new shift. We have to respond according to the new place, and that requires a new sound. So let's just take a few seconds and turn our affections toward God and give Him a new sound. Sing your old song to the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, you're so good, Jesus.
Thank you, Abba God. Thank you for being such a good God to us. Thank you for meeting here with us, oh God. Thank you for the favor of your face, oh God. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you, oh God, that you're going to meet with us and you have a word for us. God, thank you, Lord Jesus, that we're vessels yielded, God. God, I thank you for small meetings like this. You know, small meetings like this, it really tests the motive of a minister. Yet when I walk into places like this and I see it as packed as it is tonight, I really hear the Spirit speak in my heart and say, what are you in this for? Are you in this for an amen? Are you in this to be obedient to my Spirit? You know, there's so many preachers that are addicted to amens, and there's no not enough preachers that are willing to just preach according to the heart of God. And I feel like as we are ordaining a new group of people, and a new group of people are stepping into the highest office of the world, we need a fresh revelation of why we're in this thing. We don't preach just to preach. We don't preach just to sound good. But God has a message that He's trying to get directly from His heart to the hearts of the people that are listening. The Bible says, how can they hear without a preacher? How can you hear without the obedience of a man of God who would stand flat-footed on a platform on an altar of God and speak the heart of God into you? We got a whole lot of listening and a whole lot of speakers, but we don't got a lot of preachers. We don't have a lot of hearers.
All right now.
And God is taking us to a place in ministry as a body where there's a remnant inside the church.
Yes, Lord.
That while the church is growing numerically out of fear in the Lord, out of fear of the world, there's a remnant that's growing inside the church out of fear of the Lord.
All right now.
And God is taking us to a place as a people where he's asking the question, who do you say that I am?
All right now.
Who am I to you? Who am I to you? Preacher, who am I to you? Singers, who am I to you?
Oh, Lord Jesus.
Sometimes we get so caught up in the runnings and the goings and and just the motions of church that we forget the revelation. Who is God to us? When I walk into a place like this and I see three people sitting in the chairs, literally when I got here, three people, and God said, who am I to you?
Hallelujah.
Who do you say that I am?
Hallelujah.
What are you in this for?
Yeah.
What are you doing?
Hallelujah.
And I get so spiritually high because I realize that every time God asks me a question, it means that He's preparing my heart for a fresh revelation of His answer. And He's giving me a new word, a fresh spoken, a fresh rhema to let me know that there's something more awesome than my mind is willing to allow me to believe.
Yeah, praise God.
Every time doubt, you don't naturally doubt. Doubt is an attack against what God wants to do. So every time you have the spirit of doubt, that means it's attacking something greater that God is trying to download inside of you. Thank God when doubt comes on. There's a man that came to Jesus and said, Jesus, I believe.
Yes.
Oh, but God, help me with what I don't believe. God, I have faith, but help me when the doubt comes in, because I realize that doubt is only warring against the revelation of who is Jesus.
Yes.
This isn't even what I wanted to talk about, but I really feel like God has a fresh word for us.
Come on.
If you just stand your feet and just lift your hands, turn your hearts toward the Lord, and just sing a song to Jesus. Tell Him how good He is. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Meet with us, oh God. Come, Holy Spirit. Let Your kingdom come. Let Your will be done, God. In this building, God, as it is in heaven. Let Your will be done in my life as it is in heaven. Let Your will be done. Let Your kingdom come in my heart, God. God, let the results in the atmosphere of heaven be made manifest in this building, oh God. Some of us are waiting to die and go to heaven, and God is saying Jesus died so heaven can get to you.
Yeah.
We don't have to wait. Jesus, thank You.
Thank You, Lord.
Thank You, Jesus.
Thank You, Lord.
Thank You for Your word. Thank You for Your word. Something amazing happens in a marriage when a wife just simply agrees with her husband. The bridegroom is waiting on the bride to simply say, we agree with You, Jesus. We agree with You, our bridegroom. We agree with You, our husband. We agree with what You're doing. We agree with what You're saying. Pastor Tim, you can probably testify that being a minister of the gospel is often like signing your name at the bottom of a blank contract and saying, God, You fill it in every single day, and I'll do what it says to, no matter what. Even if it costs my life,
yeah,
I'll do exactly what You write on that contract.
Yeah.
Because I signed my name. name a long time ago, and I don't take it back.
Amen. Praise God.
I can't take it back.
Hallelujah.
There are people that are, their entire lives and eternal salvations are dependent on the fact that I don't take it back.
Hallelujah.
That when I sign my name to the contract, that when I said yes to God a long time ago, when I said yes to sing to the Lord, when I said yes to dance to the Lord, I didn't take it back because there's somebody that needs it. There's somebody that needs this gospel message. There's somebody that needs this gospel message. There's somebody that needs this preacher. There's a heart beating on the word that I have to speak, and I can't take it back. There's too many preachers in this world that are not preaching the gospel. And God is saying, is there one that'll just preach the gospel? There's so much noise and not enough sound. God is saying, where's the sound?
Hallelujah.
But sanctify the Lord God in your heart and be always ready to give an answer to every man that asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you.
Hallelujah.
Always ready to give an answer. Always ready to give an answer. At 3 in the morning when the phone rings, always ready to give an answer. When the ex-boyfriend hits you up on Twitter, always ready to give an answer. When the past comes creeping in and try to sneak through the back door, always ready to give an answer. When temptation comes right in your face, always ready to give an answer. When the unbeliever is watching your life, even though you're not watching your life, always ready to give an answer for this hope, this thing that we call hope. Always ready to say, here's the reason I said yes. But the problem is, Pastor Fonda, we've lost the revelation of the reason. And the reason we can't give a reason is because we forgot the reason that we had ourselves.
All right now.
God, give us a fresh revelation of the reason. Give us a fresh revelation of the reason. Oh God, our hearts cry out, give us a new reason. Give us a new reason that when they say, why is it that you signed your name to that contract? Why is it that you agree with the Holy Spirit of God? You just say, here's my
Yeah.
Here's my reason.
Yeah.
Oh God, let us be a people, oh God, that always has a reason ready.
Yeah,
we're a reason ready church.
Yeah,
too many times we're reasoning God out and God is asking us to reason Him in.
Yeah.
For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
It doesn't say whoever calls on the name of the Savior. See, everybody wants a Savior, but not a lot of people want a Lord. Everyone wants to be rescued from the fire, but no one wants the Lord to tell them to go into the fire.
All right now.
No one wants a Lord. No one wants a God, because we're grown. We've grown up too much for God. We've become too mature in our Christian walk, where we begin to not want to do what God tells us to do. And Jesus said, suffer these children to come unto me, and be for such is the kingdom. We've lost revelation of the kingdom because we've become too grown. You don't want to be little kids.
Hallelujah.
Waiting, tugging at the coattail of Abba Daddy God and saying, God, whatever you tell me to do, wherever you tell me to go, wherever you say to sing, God, and not do it out of ritual, but God, do it out of fresh revelation that this is obedience to God, that lives are hanging in the balance, that eternal souls are hanging in the balance, that somebody needs my yes to God. Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call in Him in whom they have not believed?
All right now.
And how will they believe in Him whom they have not heard? You can be seated. And how will they hear without a preacher? How will they hear without a preacher? So many times, you know what? I have a sense that I would used to cry out for more of God. The more I preach, the more I said, God, I need more of you. And God dropped this in me, Pastor Watts. He said, you'll never have more of me than you have right in this moment.
Amen. Praise God.
God doesn't come in measure.
Amen.
The moment he stepped in the fullness of his being.
Yeah.
The fullness of his presence.
Hallelujah.
100% of God at this very moment. 100% of God at this very moment.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
We don't need more of him. Less of us.
Amen.
We need to get out of the way.
Hallelujah.
We need to get out of the way.
Yes, Lord.
Because, you know, I've come to this place where I realize that, you know, Sunday after Sunday, churches are packed. There's an estimated 350,000 churches in this country. Over 318 million faithful every single Sunday churchgoers. 12 turn the world upside down. 318 million is barely making a sound.
All right now.
Preach it.
All right now.
Where are we at?
My Lord Jesus.
What have we come to?
My Lord Jesus.
What have we come to when people can come in church hurt and leave church hurt?
All right now.
What have we come to when people can come bowing and still leave bowing?
My Lord Jesus.
What is this God we believe in where people come all right and they leave more messed up?
All right now.
There's a heart cry of God for the preacher to stand up.
My Lord Jesus.
There's a heart cry of God for those who will spare, who will cry aloud and spare not.
Yeah, for me.
A heart cry of God who is for those who will say yes at any cost.
My praise God.
Those who will go to Nineveh at any cost.
Hallelujah.
Those who will say, even if it costs my life.
My Lord Jesus. My Lord.
Even if it costs my bank account.
Yeah, for me.
Even if it costs my job. You know, I asked a group of college kids once when I was in Ohio, Pastor Fund, I said, would you die for your friend? He said, yeah, I would. I said, you know, that's a noble answer. Me being the passionate guy that I am, I'd probably die for a friend too. If I saw a guy with a gun walking here right now, I'd take a bullet for any one of you in there.
My Lord Jesus.
But that's easy.
Amen.
Would you suffer for a friend?
My Lord Jesus.
It's different to die for a friend than to suffer for a friend.
Yes.
Jesus suffered for us.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
He suffered for us.
Yes, he did.
He suffered to pay for us.
Yeah.
The cross was as selfish as it was selfless.
Hallelujah.
I said the cross of Jesus was as selfish as it was selfless. God said, I've got to have Reverend Watts at any cost.
God, praise God, praise God.
I've got to get to him no matter what it costs.
Yeah, yeah.
The only thing he asks is that you come get me at any cost.
Hallelujah.
That you reciprocate my love and devotion for you with love and devotion for me. You know, yeah. The Bible says that God rejoices over us with singing and dancing.
Man, praise God.
Amen.
That's why it's so easy for me to sing and dance to him.
Praise God.
Because he first had a song and a dance in his spirit for us.
Yeah.
God, give us revelation of that song.
Hallelujah.
What are you singing over us, oh God?
Yes,
God, don't let my dance just be a dance, but let it be filled with the revelation that you're dancing over me right now.
Amen. Praise God.
You've got a dance for us.
Hallelujah.
He's got a song over us. It's interesting when I start thinking about all of the self-ordained prophets and apostles popping up out of everywhere. You know, I scroll through my Facebook and I see prophet this and apostle that.
All right now.
I see preacher this and bishop that.
All right, all right.
Offering hopeless hope.
My Lord.
Faithless faith.
My Lord.
All in an attempt to sell their Christless Christianity.
My Lord Jesus.
We're so far removed from our biblical senses, we wouldn't know God if he was standing in our face.
All right now.
There's a cruel and dying world out there.
Man.
And somehow it's infiltrated the church. Now, if you spend any length of time outside of this church, you may not know what I'm about to tell you.
All right now.
The gospel of Jesus Christ is under attack.
Yes, Lord.
Now, I know you've got a pastor here that preaches the gospel of Jesus, who stands flat-footed in the face of the devil and say, devil, you can't have these people, and he's going to preach the Holy Ghost truth of the Word of God. But there is a group of people in the world that have diluted the gospel of Jesus. The gospel of Jesus Christ is under attack. God is looking for the one. He doesn't even need everybody. He just needs one.
Amen.
One who will say yes.
Amen. Praise God.
Yes, at any cost.
Yes.
Yes, if it costs my life.
Amen.
Yes, if it costs my job. Yes, if it costs everything. Yes, if it costs my friends. Yes, if it costs my popularity. Yes, if it costs everything I've worked all my life to build. Yes, if it costs my dreams. Yes, if it costs my ambitions. Yes, if it costs my college degree. Yes, if it costs everything that I've ever worked for. We have to get a people that is willing to just say yes.
Amen.
Yes, God.
Amen.
Yes, God. Yes, God. Whatever you tell me to do today, yes. Wherever you tell me to go, yes. We get so used to our patterns that we take the same route to work every day. We take the same route home every day. We have the same routines. We meet at Starbucks at the same time every week. We become so ritualized and routine that we don't even know what a real yes looks like.
All right now.
Because a real yes means I have to do something different today than what I did yesterday.
Amen.
A real yes means that I have to step out of my comfort zone.
Yeah. Yeah.
A real yes means I have to be like Peter and step out the boat.
All right now.
Man. A real yes means I have to, after I step out the boat, I have to push the boat away.
Hallelujah.
I have to live without options.
Praise God.
I have to live without a plan B.
All right.
I have to live without a backup plan.
All right.
I have to live that there's that my only option is yes to God.
Amen.
My only option is yes to obedience. Yes. My only option is yes to love. My only option is yes to what he told me. My only option is yes to what he put in my heart. My only option is everything that he told me from the very beginning. My only option is God. I have no backup plan. I push the boat away. When God called me to preach, I said yes, and I had to look back.
Praise God, praise God.
When God called me to preach, I said yes.
Amen.
And sometimes your yes will require a no.
My Lord Jesus.
Sometimes saying yes to God means saying no to the very thing you've been praying for.
All right now.
Sometimes saying yes to God means saying no to the thing that makes you happy.
Hallelujah.
Some people don't want God.
All right. Man.
Some people don't want God.
Right.
How can you take his hand and not his face?
Amen.
How can you take what he's giving and not what he's willing to take?
Praise God.
The news of the media provide sufficient evidence for our need for a sound gospel, a saving Savior. Wars, earthquakes, famines, disease, crime are all indicative of our desperate depravity and our humanity's greatest necessity. You know, I'm thinking about the upcoming election and all of the people that are waiting on a president to do what the preacher is supposed to do.
Oh, come on.
They're waiting on the White House to do what the church house is supposed to do. Revival's not going to flow from the White House.
Amen.
It's going to flow to the White House.
Yes.
From the church house. From a group of preachers that have preached to a people, and from a group of people who then say yes and preach the gospel to everything created.
Amen.
You know, the Bible says preach the gospel to all creation.
Yeah.
It doesn't say just all humans.
Amen.
That's right.
Everything created.
Amen. Praise God.
Needs the gospel.
Yes, Lord.
Every system needs the gospel. Every program needs the gospel.
Amen.
Every government needs the gospel.
Yeah.
And we can, how will they hear without a preacher who says yes?
Man, praise God.
A preacher who says yes.
Yes, Lord.
I've learned that the war that we're facing is not really against ISIS. It's not against Israel. It's not against Muslims. It's not about homosexuality. It's not about Prop A. It's not about Obama. It's not about who gets in. It's not about Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. It's not about any of that.
Praise God.
The real war right now is against the gospel and gospel preachers.
Amen.
It's against the gospel and gospel preachers.
Amen. God.
God wants a heart that says, I'll do it.
Yes, Lord.
I'll be that preacher.
Amen.
I'll preach that gospel.
Yes, Lord.
Paul said, if anyone comes to you, even if an angel from heaven comes to you and preaches a different gospel,
I'll be a curse.
There's something powerful about this gospel. There's something amazing about this gospel. The Bible says that, that I will not be ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. It is the power of God.
Yes,
I will not be ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God.
Yes, Lord.
It is the power of God. Healings and signs and wonders and miracles, I've been there, I've done that, but it's not the power, the only power of God. is found in the gospel. And if you preach the gospel, you'll find miracle signs and wonders. If you preach the gospel, you'll find answers to every problem. If you preach the gospel.
Hallelujah.
We need gospel preachers in the world today.
Yeah.
We need real gospel preachers in the world today. We live in such a biblically illiterate generation. We live in a generation, there's less people, while there are more people going to church, there's less people that know the Bible.
Right. Praise God.
How can we say we know Him? We haven't even read of Him. We haven't even studied His Word. We haven't even looked upon the pages in which He authored.
Man.
How can we know Him without studying who He is?
Hallelujah.
It's interesting because I started watching recently the trend of churches. And it seems like everybody with a microphone is called pastor. Everyone who grabs a microphone is somehow a preacher.
Right.
It's funny because I've watched anyone who can make, let's say, a general observation about their life is called a prophet.
Right.
Punchlines and catchphrases are no longer belong to the comedian but are found week after week in a pulpit across America. If you can rhyme, they'll give you their time. If you say it twice, they'll say amen. I said, if you say it twice, they'll say amen. And the voice by which you know God, forgetting the word of His own Son. My sheep know my voice.
Amen.
And follow me.
Yes.
Not TV Jake's voice.
Amen.
Not Joel Olstein's voice. Not your preacher's voice. Voice of God.
Amen.
A real friend will ask you, what's the last thing God told you? A real friend will ask you, what has God been speaking to you?
Hallelujah.
You ought to have a fresh word of God for your life.
Yes, brothers.
Not to preach. I don't study to preach. I study to learn.
Amen.
Amen.
And I only preach what I learn.
Amen.
Praise God.
Because if you study to preach, that means you're studying for, that means your intimacy is done only as a profession.
Right.
And those who are intimate as a profession are called prostitutes.
Right.
If you only study to preach, that means your only intimacy comes out of a profession. And those who are intimate as a profession are called prostitutes. And a lot of times preachers have been prostituting God.
My Lord,
that's good.
And not only will they prostitute God, they'll prostitute gifts.
My Lord.
They'll prostitute the saints for their money.
My Lord Jesus.
It, you know, I remember one time I was in the grocery store with my sister, and I made a comment about a TV preacher that I saw it. His book was in the grocery store. It said something. And it was a lady, before I could even finish my thought, she interjected, jumped in my conversation, all up in my business. And said, hey man, you can't talk about that preacher like that. Who, me? And she told me that I was being offensive to God because I wasn't supposed to harm His anointed. Do not bring harm to the prophet.
All right now.
You know that scripture, that touch not my anointed, neither do my prophets any harm.
Amen.
Oh, no, I think that's the only scripture this lady knew. No. And I didn't respond to this lady's ignorance because instead I just asked her a question that challenged the motive of her heart. I said, hey, when's the last time you won a soul to the Lord?
All right, now.
She bragged about winning 3 souls in her lifetime. And while that's commendable because it's more than most folks, it just struck me as strange because with the same boldness and tenacity it took her to interrupt my conversation and defend this TV preacher, if she had that same boldness to defend the gospel of Jesus Christ,
amen.
All right now,
she'd be more effective.
Yeah.
But a lot of times our devotion is found more with the preachers behind the microphone than a God who's written His word in our hearts.
Amen. Praise God. Amen.
What is God saying? What is God saying? The truth is, people know more about their celebrity preachers than they know about the Lord.
All right.
The world is a really cold and crooked place, and we need someone big enough and bold enough to proclaim the name of Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
We need someone big enough and bold enough to proclaim the name of Jesus.
Man.
You know he's called the Rock of Offense.
Yeah.
You know his name is called True and Holy.
Yeah.
It's the name by which it is given under heaven, by which no man no man can be saved. It is the only name given under heaven by which. That's right. There's no other name under heaven given by which. Yeah, there it is. That's right. That's right. I wrote my notes wrong.
Amen.
You know, Jesus is the name that got a football coach fired for praying.
All right now.
Jesus is the name that got a bakery shut down after a lawsuit because they just said no.
All right.
No to the world and yes to God.
Come on. Amen.
Jesus is the name that gets news anchors fired.
Mm-hmm. All right now.
Yes,
seriously.
Yes, it is.
Jesus is the name that gets politicians in trouble.
Yes. All right.
Jesus is the name that causes courthouses to change the entire laws of the land.
All right now, amen.
Millions of people in this world, millions of people right here in this country are affected by the name by the offense to the name of Jesus.
Amen. All right now.
When's the last time you got in trouble for the name of Jesus?
Hallelujah, Jesus. All right.
When's the last time the name of Jesus got you in trouble?
My Lord Jesus.
See, what I realize is there's a lot of cookies, cake, and bubblegum preaching.
Mm-hmm.
All the sweet stuff that tastes good now and makes you sick later.
Man,
there's a lot of people preaching everything but Jesus.
All right.
They preach around Jesus. They preach about Jesus, but they don't preach Jesus.
All right now.
Because when you preach Jesus, you offend some.
Yes, you do. Man.
When you preach Jesus, you don't have a packed out church.
Hallelujah.
When you preach Jesus, you're not popular.
All right.
When you preach Jesus, they don't put your name on Facebook and tag you in it.
All right now.
Because when you preach Jesus, it means you verse. You know, they didn't kill Jesus because he was sweet.
That's right.
They didn't kill Jesus because he preached, love your cat, love your dog, and if you just don't strife, everything will be all right.
All right now.
If you just love everybody and wake up in the morning and just do right, do good, everything will be all right.
All right now. All right now. All right. All right.
They killed Jesus because he had a message that offended an entire nation.
Amen.
Amen.
What are you preaching? What is your life preaching?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
I'm almost done. I don't want to keep us here all night. But, you know, we need preachers who aren't afraid to preach Jesus. We need preachers who are more obedient to their call than they are their own bank account. We need preachers like the Apostle Paul that says, I beat my body and make it a slave, so even after I preach, I've been disqualified from receiving a prize.
All right now.
We need preachers whose only prize is found in their obedience to Christ.
Amen.
And not in the paycheck they get after.
Amen.
We need preachers who are used to preaching to three people.
Hallelujah.
We need preachers who are used to not knowing where their next meal is coming from.
Man, praise God.
We need some preachers who don't care where their next paycheck is coming from.
Hallelujah.
We need preachers who know what it's like to cry and ask the Lord how their bill is going to get paid.
Man,
we need those kind of preachers. Because those kind of preachers will not compromise because they've been there and they've done that.
Amen.
Amen.
We need real preachers of God.
Hallelujah.
Romans 1:16, I will not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. We need preachers who will preach the gospel that will change this world, because
right.
Only the gospel can change the world.
Yeah.
ISIS needs the gospel.
Amen.
ISIS needs the gospel.
Amen. Yes.
Christian killers need the gospel.
Amen.
Christian killers need the gospel. Your boss needs the gospel.
All right now.
The lady living next door to you needs the gospel.
Yeah.
Amen.
That person that keeps blowing up your phone, they need the gospel.
Yeah.
Amen.
The people on your Facebook, they need the gospel.
Amen.
Yeah.
The people you see every day at Starbucks, they need the gospel.
Yeah.
The people you see at Safeway every day, they need the gospel.
Amen.
Yeah.
Everywhere you go, there's people in need of what you have.
Amen. Praise God.
You know, the Lord showed it to me like this one, Pastor Father. He showed me that picture the whole world dying a slow, painful death. Let's say it's AIDS. Let's say the whole world has AIDS and you're the only one with a cure.
All right now.
And yet you walk by them every day and smile.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Say, bless you. God bless you. How are you feeling? I'm blessed and highly favored.
All right now.
We give them our Christianese. We invite them to our church services. The whole while hoarding the one thing they need. Loving them all the way to hell.
All right now.
Because we're so afraid of offending them with the truth of our medicine.
My Lord Jesus.
That we'd rather see them happy and unsaved.
Yes, Lord.
Than mad at the gospel. And
hallelujah, Jesus.
We need preachers who will do it. I just wanted to thank God, and then I'm done, and then just after, we're going to pray one more time. I just wanted to thank God for Pastor Tim, for the IMA, for a ministry that ordains preachers.
Amen.
For a ministry that releases preachers of God.
Amen.
For a ministry that raises up preachers of God.
Hallelujah.
Real preachers. You want to thank God, you know a real preacher. See, if you've been in this church for a length of time, you've probably been in a Jesus bubble. That means you don't really know that outside of this church, there's a whole bunch of speakers and not enough preachers.
Amen. Praise God.
There's a whole lot of buildings and not a lot of churches. Seriously, thank God for your pastor. Thank God for your preacher. Thank God for someone who says that you. Thank God for someone who tells you when you're wrong. Thank God. Let's pray. Let's throw our hearts to the Lord. Stand up and move around. Shake yourself. Go like this. Do something weird. Do something crazy. Be free of the Lord. And let's just spend like 25 seconds in a praise and prayer. Can we do that? Let's just shout unto the Lord. Hallelujah!
Men and women that criticize you, Pastor Ray,
Many of them have gone to their grave. Many of them have gone to their grave. They're in Jesus' hands now. But you see, he spoke a word over you and he said, the latter house, Pastor Ray, the latter house is going to be greater than the former house. 128 churches.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yes. I don't know what God is going to do with your life, Pastor Watts, Pastor Dodson, but I do know this. Hold on. Hold on. Because he's going to take you where you've never been before. He's going to open doors that no man can shut. He's going to pour out his anointing like a river from heaven. We're going to stand. We're going to stand and we're going to see the salvation of the Lord. We're going to see the salvation of the Lord in the lives of unbelievers. We're going to see the salvation of the Lord in church folk that have been coming to church that haven't been preaching and loving and hanging on to every word of the gospel of Jesus. We're going to see the salvation of the Lord in pastors that have been playing church in the pulpit. But God's going to send you in there, and the words you speak, the words you speak are going to convict them to follow their ease and repent, and to turn their hearts toward the Almighty, righteous God, and allow Him to do the work they were called to do.
Hallelujah.
Oh. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
You see, they're selling the world a fake package of goods. They're selling the church a fake package. Because if you love somebody, you give them what they need, not what's going to kill them.
Hallelujah.
And the true love of Jesus Christ is the gospel that only He came. Only He can save the lost.
Amen.
You see, you don't love a drug addict by giving them more drugs.
Amen.
Right.
You don't love a thief by providing an opportunity for them to steal. You don't love a liar by propagating their lies.
Amen.
You love them by telling the truth.
Amen.
That a mighty God came. And because He was perfect, He can be their perfection.
Amen.
And He can pull them out of the drug addiction.
Amen.
He can deliver them from the alcoholism.
Yeah.
He can deliver them from unrighteous living.
Hallelujah.
You know, the word holy has been misperceived, and I think a lot of times it's been turned into something just the opposite of what it is. Holy doesn't mean self-righteous. Holy doesn't mean looking the part.
That's right. Hallelujah.
Holy means set apart.
Yes.
Set aside, set apart.
Yeah, right.
Not put on the shelf. But set aside for a particular purpose.
Yeah.
You don't take a coffee pot.
All right, now.
And try to make soup in it.
All right. All right.
Do you? Not many people I know do.
Man, praise God. No.
You don't take a flower vase and try to drink your hot chocolate out of it, do you?
Man, praise God.
You don't take a pot to hold a tree and use it as a shoe.
All right.
You don't put a lampshade on your head.
Apologies.
And wear it like a hat.
All right, now.
you're set aside for a purpose.
Amen.
A purpose.
Yes.
God says He has a particular purpose.
Amen.
Where He's been fulfilling it in your life.
Yeah.
And, you know, Bishop Garrison says, a word spoken is spoken to all present, that you can get it in the overflow. Amen.
Oh, Jesus.
Because the words spoken are truth.
Amen.
If it's the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
If we're speaking the Word of God, it applies to all of us, because all Scripture is given for edification, for instruction,
right,
prophecy.
Amen.
Right. All Scripture.
Yes.
But don't buy into that when you're talking to somebody and say, oh, but that was for the Jews, or that was for the Canaanites, or no. Say all Scripture.
All Scripture.
That's why God was very particular in the way that He didn't just include every book that might have some good information as canonized Scripture.
Hallelujah.
He was very careful what He considered Scripture. There might be something of value in reading other books.
Hallelujah.
But you can't depend on every word of other books as instruction and truth for your life that you can apply to you every day. All Scripture applies to you every day. And the Spirit of God that lives in you will bring you to life. Amen?
Amen.
The Spirit's lifted for me. I just wanted to be obedient and encourage you, let you know that we're not just playing church. We're not just here to hand out some pieces of paper to make each other feel good. Although we do edify and encourage one another and lift each other up and, you know, tell each other the good things about each other. That's all good and godly. But we are here for a purpose. And God is doing a mighty work. And we're going to be workers together with God. And this morning, the Lord asked me to ask for a specific prayer request. Now, I'm not a big numbers person, so I know it's got to be the Lord, because, you know, I saw a king get in trouble for numbering God's people.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
But I want our ministers affiliated with us to pray for us, and those that are right here serving with us to agree with me, and we'll all agree together.
Hallelujah.
That I said, Lord, You said we would not grow this building by reaching the lost. Amen.
Amen.
We were going to reach the lost.
They
were going to see miracles, signs, and wonders, and we were going to outgrow this facility and have to put up a bigger one. Amen? And the number that came to me was, the Lord said, okay, the fire marshal said 84 can sit out there, and 58 can sit up there. That's 142 people. I want you to pray with me that within the next few months, I'm not talking long time, the next few months that God will do a work, and that we will reach that capacity. That we will reach 142 people. That we'll have 58 up there worshiping on the platform. Hey, we're doing pretty good on that part of it. We have, I think, 23 on the platform, 20 on the platform. And we have 3 in the seats tonight. So we can't get that jointed. But we can have 58 on the platform. We can have 84 in the congregation until we are not legally occupying this building. I don't know, 142. That's not too difficult for God.
Amen.
That is not too difficult for God.
Amen.
And I just want you to pray for us. And as that anointing flows and we grow and God enlarges our territory and our borders, He's going to do the same in the mission places He has you. Amen? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, let's close out tonight. I see if I'm forgetting anything we have on our program. There's a shower Saturday. What time? 2:30 right here for the ladies. The ladies are going to come and they're going to bring baby gifts for a baby girl, right? Oh, a baby boy. Yeah, you're listening good. That's for Nina. For Nina's baby. Amen. They're going to bring presents here and they're going to bring themselves. They're going to have a good time. They're going to celebrate that baby on Saturday. And we're going to have a good time with the Lord. A little while.
Pastor Molly was delivering the message. There's an old song we used to sing a long time ago.
Yeah.
I made a vow unto the Lord and I
Bible.
That's right.
Ah, amen, amen. You want to sing
it? I made a vow to the Lord, and I won't take it back. I made a vow to the Lord, and I won't take it back. It was a holy vow, and I won't take it back. It was a holy vow, and I won't take it back. I'm on my knees when I made that vow, and I won't take it back. I was on my knees when I made that vow, and I won't take it back. I made a vow to the Lord, and I won't take it back. I made a vow to the Lord, and I won't take it back. I won't take it back, and I won't take it back. I was on my knees when I made that vow, and I won't take it back. I was on
speaks to me and shows me visions. But then I had to tell them, I said, look, I said, it doesn't matter if he speaks to you and shows you visions now. I said, the problem is you got to realize in the midst of what you're in, if he lifts his hands off you, he can take away those visions and the things that you see. I said, so what he's telling you in this time, in this season, it's time for you to come in. It's time for you to quit playing around. It's time for you to quit doing all the stuff that you're doing. And I told him, I just said, I got to just tell you the truth. I can't tell you no different than that. I said, I would be at fault to just sit here and lie to you. Sit here and lie to you and make you think that it's all good.
Yeah.
I said, because long as you think that it's all good and you're seeing these visions and seeing all these things, God has a hand on your heart, but it's time for you to get
right. That's right.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Personally, I'm not a minister in a speaking type, but.
All right.
I am for the Lord, but you know, I want to give just a little bit of background on my work in Peru. Some years ago, I lost everything in life, and I came to a point in life that I wanted to commit suicide.
Wow.
So I spent a year with a gun under my pillow all night. I was contemplating that suicide.
Wow, wow.
And the Lord took and brought Peru out of that desperation. What happened is, I got up one night and I spent 2 o'clock in the morning and I was by myself in a house. I was building $1 million house. And I leaned over onto the sinkboard of the house when I was alone, nobody there but me. And I was sleeping in the house where I was working. I leaned over on the sink and I said, in my heart to the Lord, I said, Lord, why don't you get rid of me? I can't have a life anymore.
Wow. Wow, Jesus.
And he answered me from the ceiling in an audible voice in that bathroom upstairs. And he said to me, it was away from the door, and he said to me in an audible voice, he said, no, because I'm not through with you yet.
Amen.
And praise God.
And it was from that point. 5 days later, from that point, I got a call from a pastor in another town, in Woodland, in fact, and I didn't know this pastor, and he didn't know what my qualifications was because I was a firefighter at the time, but he asked me on the phone, he said, is this Ray? And I said, yeah. I said, I don't know you, but I said, he said, the Lord, I've been looking for you for 5 days. He said, the Lord told me 5 days ago that I was to call a man by the name of Ray Young and ask him to come out and build and design our church for us.
My Lord Jesus.
Well, now, why would he do that? I don't have a degree in anything. I went to Bible college 1 year. I couldn't read the college system up for the courses that God wanted me, that they wanted me to take. I just couldn't keep up with that. And so I had 4 years paid, but I decided that I wasn't worth that. So I walked out. So I moved my family to California, to Northern California from that point. And when I came into this point with this pastor, he said to me, I've been looking for you for 5 days. I don't know where to find you. And someone told me to call for this number. He said, it was you. And he says, can you do that for me? I said, well, I have a big job to do here. And I was just about finished with the big home I was working on, but the Lord said that you could do it. And so I said, well, if the Lord wants me to, he's going to cancel all my jobs out here. And he did within the next 5 days or so. So I called the pastor up and I said, Pastor, I said, first of all, I don't have a degree. I was a designer by trade because the government appointed me. I designed parachute drops for the U.S. military that has been used in every Coast Guard plane around the world today. And I've never had an education in that thing. I've had shops and stuff, but it all things that I've got has been given to me by God. It's not something I've earned.
Hallelujah.
So I took the challenge and I said to the pastor, I said, if the Lord wants me to, he's going to cancel all my work. And he did. So I called him up and I said, I'll be out there. I'll take all my tools out and I'll start to work. So I spent the next 4 years designing and building Woodland Assemblies of God Church. It's a three-story church.
Wow.
And I had an engineer that did the work for me as an engineer, but I could design the church because I had already worked in aircraft and design of aircraft and design of buildings in a small way, but I've never taken a big project like that. But the Lord took a nobody and took from that point on and said, I'm not through with it yet, to make the work begin to focus in Peru. In the meantime, I finished that church and I was then called by the military to go back to Connecticut. And I'm a first class petty officer in the military. They sent me to Connecticut and to work in the research and development lab and probably in a captain's position, and I'm just a first class petty officer. I had a captain from Los Angeles came up from Los Angeles to help to me and give me and say, oh, I come up to review the work you're doing and see if you're qualified to do the job that they want in Washington, D.C. He wrote the letter and said that he's more than qualified, put him on the job. So they activated me out of the fire department and sent me to Connecticut. I went back there and designed projects that was almost impossible, plus the parachute drop. Now, the next thing is that after I finished that commission, I came back and I designed the sanctuary of the church out in Woodland. The pastor said, would you do it for me? And I said, sure. The engineer I was working with was an awesome guy and easy to work with, and so I did got the sanctuary done, and I didn't ask for any money for 5 years when I worked with that job. They didn't have the money. They were a poor church. And so I did it for nothing, but they did give me a tip at the end of the job. But the basic thing, what they did for me, is it saved my life. Because 5 years that I worked in that church out there healed my mind, my heart, and my soul. And I've seen Jesus work on the miracles in my life. And from that point on, then, I retired from the Sacramento City Fire Department in 1990, and the Lord didn't choose to use me until 2000. But part of that, he led up to it because I housed Rosie in Peru. Barb and I, t- took her in, and we were able to converse together. We didn't know each other's language, but God brought her to that point, and then she graduated here with her degree and went back to Peru and married a Peruvian military weapons officer for Peru. But she wouldn't marry him until he resigned his commission with the government to take on a full-time position as an evangelist for Peru. Because she didn't know, wasn't going to marry anybody unless they were minister, but God had already called him into the ministry. And at that point, she married him, and he was preaching one day. He got ordained for a while with another organization. He's now with us as an IMA, and he went to
Brazil.
I'm trying to get my story in my mind. They were called to Brazil, but what happened is that his old military team came to kill him in the platform. And that was because he knew too much about the weapons of Peru. And what happened was that a runner ahead of the group came and sneaked him off to Brazil. For the next 12 years, they were in Brazil. And after they got their degrees in education in Brazil, they already had their minister's license and degrees. They started three churches in Brazil. And during that time, got their doctor's degree in education, and then called me and said, "Dad, we've been given permission to go back to Israel, to Peru, and work in Peru, and start a school for children in there, and poverty children." And she said, Rosie said, would you help us do that? So I said to my wife, "Would you help me?" And she did. And between that, that's where the work in Peru started. That's when Rosie called me. And I flew there, and I had never been in Peru in my life before. And when I went there, I had just had major surgery. I brought 200 pounds of computers on the way to, and I flew there to Peru. In fact, when I landed at LAX, I couldn't go to bed anywhere. I had to sit with my stuff because they wouldn't put it on into the airplane luggage place until we flew out the next morning. So I had to sit with my luggage, and I flew and landed in Peru. And when I landed, I said to the Lord, I said, "What in the world are you doing sending me to a place like this? It was so God forsaken that I couldn't hardly believe that He was doing that to me."
But
God took a miracle out of suicide to bring me into the place to start a work. And I wasn't anything. I wasn't a nobody. I was criticized for pastors.
All right now.
And for doing what I was doing. And I was rejected by other denominations to have a covering by them. But God took a nobody and made something out of it. And today we have 128 new churches. We have three Bible colleges and two elementary schools. And pastor has been to those, and I've taken him to the. And he showed this morning the many churches that he won. That's just a background behind a nothing, nobody, to a point of what God's brought me in today. Thanks for listening.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Brother Wayne. Glad to share. You know, we're going to Peru. God willing, in May, and then to an advanced trip. We have a doctor that works with a team of doctors, and we're going to go assess what the greatest medical needs are there. We're going to visit the 128 churches, or at least the pastors. We're going to try to bring them together into groupings that are close to each other. And so when we go back in September, we're going to try to have like a clinic or something at each one to give out general supplies, vitamins, and this type of thing. And the judge is going to go with us as well. We got a team of people that want to go. And we are going to, God willing, mobilize the different churches, 120 churches, when we're there in May, bring them the teaching to train their workers to evangelize working up into the crusade we're going to have in September. And in September, they're giving us the soccer stadium in the city so that we can have a major crusade. And our goal is to have a medical endeavor there, a clinic, where they'll take care of some things, maybe even partner with one of the local hospitals that are there and provide free services in the day. And then in the evening, have a crusade, a healing crusade, and a salvation crusade, where we bring the members from the 128 churches. And so it's going to be a big endeavor. And hopefully those members will have filled up buses or whatever transportation we can figure out when we go in April or May to bring people from the bush country to all come to get worship together and to have a healing crusade, an American crusade, a salvation crusade, amen, and bring more people of Christ. You know, those students that are in those schools are the poorest of the poor, and they could not have afforded this school in Peru. And they got a first-class education last year. The test scores came back, and our schools ranked number one in the nation for academic standing. Amen. Hallelujah. Higher than the Montessori schools, higher than all of the Catholic schools. Our schools, Christian schools of Peru, ranked number one in academic standing. So they were teaching like grade 9 calculus when I was there. So it's not just a mediocre endeavor. God has done this first class all the way. The last time we were there, they needed a playground. So God led me out back to pray and started praying in some tongues. We got home, and a few months later, we got a call that the adjacent property was donated to them to turn into a playground for the children. Amen. So, you know, God is on the move. And so we are going to continue and grow this. We're going to be workers together with God as He grows the ministry in Peru. And we pray we'll be going to, we've been invited to India. We've been invited to Israel. We're supposed to have a Judah Fest in Israel. But God's timing is God's timing, you know. And there's these different things. But we are a mission-minded church. We're a home missions and a foreign missions and college campus missions. We're going to make an impact on the world for Jesus Christ. And just as Chassé prayed, we are going to reach out. Was it Chassé that prayed? The millions of people. The millions of people. How big is your God? Amen. How big is your God? Amen. Millions of people are going to come to salvation. And go preach the gospel. I want to encourage you as you go out, try to get somebody, even if it's amateur, to bring a video camera and video the things that you're doing, and we'll put it on our channel that we have on YouTube already, and we'll highlight what God is doing in the various fields that He has you ministering in. So we're growing. God is doing something spectacular in our lives, and it's not by might nor by power, but by His Spirit. Let's stand together as we close. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is that Tala?
Telly?
Yeah, turn your table. I say it like a telephone, Tala. But I say it wrong, I'm sure. But this young woman has a calling of a minister on her life as well. She ministers to the youth at their rallies, and she did a great job with the Parsha. Amen, last week. And Pastor Fonda and I were away. And I would just like to have you close us out in prayer and pray over the people. Amen? And then do that couple spot. You don't have to preach tonight. Pretty soon. But let's close out in prayer tonight and bless all those. And go ye, amen? Go ye and preach the gospel.
Hallelujah. Let's go ahead and bow our heads before God in prayer. Lord, Heavenly Father, we've come to the conclusion, to the ending of our program tonight, Father God. We've heard you speak through our ministers, through preachers, through your music, through everything that we've been through tonight. Father God, I ask that you let this seed grow within our hearts, Father God, so that we may exit this building and be a blessing to anyone we come across, Father God. Let us continue to save more souls for your kingdom, Father God, through our families, through our friends, and reach out to our community. I pray that you bless this evening as we depart, Father God. Protect us as we go on our way home, Father God. Bless everyone who's here today, those who weren't able to make it, Father God. I pray that you bless them. And I pray that you let us be a light in this community, Father God. Bless Pastor Timothy and everybody here in this building. Thank you, Father God. To you alone be all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. And everybody say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.